They are poultry's friends. Welcome to episode number 6 of Turn In with the Experts. In this episode, we are going to discuss with Guillermo Gonzalez about how to diagnose Gumboro disease. So stay tuned with the experts and know all about controlling Gumboro disease. Enjoy. So hello again, dear poultry's friends. We are here for another episode with Guillermo Gonzalez to discuss a little bit about the diagnosis of Gumboro disease. In the last episode, we discussed with him about the epidemiology of the Gumboro disease. And in that time, I remember that you shared with us what the strains we are finding, the virus strains that we are finding in different countries, right? So in this time, I would like to ask you how we can monitor it in the field, in the customer perspective, how they can monitor it, how they can realize if what they can find in the field, or what impact it can cause to their production.
Yes, for sure, they can monitor the impact of any foreign Gumboro virus, and they can also measure if they have applied the vaccine well. We have two things in Ceva. First thing is we have something called the CHIC program, and what we do with the CHIC program is we make sure that the vaccine is properly applied and mixed in the hatchery. Later on, by means of something we call GPS, we make sure that the birds are properly immunized. So we have two legs of the same program. One program is to properly apply the vaccine. The second leg of that program is to see if the birds really develop the immune response. Having said that, we also measure the detect the vaccine. And what we do to measure that is we take bursas, fresh bursas from birds in the farm, and we imprint them on FDA cards and send them to the lab. So by doing that, you have a higher chance of detecting the vaccine virus in the bursa. And that's how you measure the quality of the application of the vaccine.
You mentioned already some of the tools that we can have to monitor. And you can have a lot of tools to monitor since on the farms, looking to the broiler healthy, to the bursa, and connect, of course, with the lab monitoring, mm-hmm. PCR, serology, histopathology, all these kind of tools. To us, start on this on this point. Can we go deeper a little bit? What we can see in the bursa on the farms? How we can analyze it on the farms?
It depends on the vaccine you apply. I must assume we are talking about transient. So what we see in the bursa is changes in the bursa, because we are applying a live vaccine. We want the live vaccine to replicate in the bursa, which is the desired effect of the vaccine. So what we will see is that the bursa will be depleted. It will be smaller once the vaccine is applied. And after a certain time, the bursa will come back to a bigger state, I would say. So the bursa will be larger after some days. It will arrive first to an atrophy, and then it will be reverted to a bigger state, back to, let's say, normality. And because the lymphocytes migrate from different areas of the body. So what we want to see with transient is that the bursa is affected, because it's the only way you're sure that the virus is taking the bursa. But we are talking not about any virus, that the vaccine virus is taking the bursa. So definitely what you want to see is effects in the bursa.
And how we can compare it if you're using a different vaccination program?
Well, if you want to compare between different vaccination programs, the first thing you need to do is you need to check which vaccine you're applying. It's not the same to compare a vectorized vaccine with an immune complex or a drinking water vaccine with an immune complex. And I will explain it very quickly. A vectorized vaccine will never change the bursa, has no effects in the bursa, because a vectorized vaccine is using a MARC serotype 3 virus. So the MARC serotype 3 virus is not invading the bursa. Okay, there will be no effects in the bursa. If you see effects in the bursa in a flock which is vaccinated with a recombinant HPT vaccine, that tells you that there is something more than the vaccine you're applying. It will be an external virus, foreign virus, that is invading and replicating in the bursa. So that's for recombinant HPT vaccine. When you take drinking water vaccines, in most cases, we are dealing with very mild drinking water vaccines. So because of the administration of the drinking water vaccines, the chance of having a negative vaccine detection is very high. The vaccines applied via drinking water have, they present a lot of different factors that can influence the administration of the vaccine. It's not the same as when you apply in ovo, that you have one dose applied in ovo and you are 99% of the cases sure, at least with the data we have in the CHIK program, you are 99% sure that the vaccine is being correctly applied per CHIK. It's not the case with drinking water vaccines. It depends on the chlorinated water. It depends on how you mix the vaccine in the farm. It depends on the expertise of the person applying the vaccine. There are many factors that come into play. And mostly what we see with our data we have, and we have several years of data in GPS, as I mentioned before, that demonstrates the vaccine take is never enough with drinking water vaccines. We also have another type of drinking water and innovo vaccines, which are the very invasive vaccines, very unsafe vaccines, which are, for example, not approved in Europe because of the very negative effects, safety effects on the birds. These kind of vaccines are very invasive. Also, drinking water presentation is very invasive, and we can also have a negative effect on the performance of the birds. As I said, immune complex, applied in ovo, one shot per chick, and you are sure that it replicates in the bursa.
Going to the lab results, some doubts can come when you have serological interpretation, serological results, okay? What do you extract from a serological result?
Our experience with serology is very vast. When we have our first discussion with customers, the first thing we always explain is, I want to use serology to control my flocks. We usually assume that 100% of our customers use serology on a regular basis. So the first thing when we enter into discussion to start running GPS, our veterinary services activities in customers, is that first of all, we need to know what is our baseline. Once that you have your baseline, once that you know what the situation looks like in the farm and in your operations, then you can start talking about serology. But we always say standalone serologies tell you nothing. Serologies combined with PCR, combined with performance data, that will tell you the truth. But serology as a standalone component will tell you nothing. Well, you cannot difference, if you only use serology, you cannot difference between live vaccines, recombinant vaccines, or foreign viruses. You cannot make the difference.
And you mentioned PCR, that can be an excellent tool to monitor the virus circulation, the strains that are circulating in the farm, right? How we can use it? It can be used to understand the dynamic of the challenge in the field?
It depends on when you take the sample. If we are talking about Gumboro and we are taking consecutive samples in a farm, if we start taking samples, for example, at day 21 of age, every 7 days, let's say 21, 28, 35, and so on, you can see the percentage of vaccine detection of the foreign, in this case, it's not a foreign IVDV, but you can measure the percentage of the vaccine strain in the bursas. So you can see the percentage at 21 days until 35 days. What we see when we apply transmune is that it starts to increase in percentage of vaccine detection. And after some time, it goes down again and it tells you something. It tells you that the virus finalized the replication phase and the bursa, as I said at the very beginning of this talk, comes back to normality. There is no more atrophy and it regenerates and comes back to normality. And you can see that with the PCR, but you need several time points to measure that.
So thanks, Guillermo, for this valuable information, how to monitor the Gumboro challenge. And to close, I would like to ask you if you have any advice for the vets in the field.
Well, if I can give an advice, which is already a little bit tricky, I always say you need to enjoy what you're doing. So if I need to advise any colleague, younger colleague, I'm not that young anymore. So if I need to advise any young colleague, enjoy your job. Have ears, eyes, and enjoy your job. Do what you like, travel a lot, find different challenges, enjoy what you're doing, and try to always challenge your counterparts. That's very healthy.
Okay. With this really nice advice for all of you, I would like to close. Thanks again, Guillermo, and please keep with us.
Thank you, Marco.
Thank you for watching this episode. And do not hesitate to give us your feedback by commenting down below in the comment section. Goodbye, stay safe.